thank you very much. I will be moving through this list fairly fast. There is a detailed post around there if you have questions. So the title property of colossal monetary additive compounds is presented here in this new graph. Here you have resistivity of dot lanthanum manganese oxide at zero magnetic field, plotted in a logarithmic scale and showing a peak somewhere close to the ferromagnetic Curie temperature. As you apply a magnetic field of 9 Tesla, this peak gets blurred and shifted to the right. So then if you subtract one curve from the other, you get a peak in magnetic resistance, which is called colossal magnetic resistance. Now this happens in materials of varying chemical composition. There can be different kinds here and different crystal structure. Here you have a perovskite, here you have a bilayer compounds. Here you can see in more details the magnetization curves at various fields, the resistivities and the magnetic resistance. And there is a number of generic unconventional magnetic and electronic properties shown by those compounds. One of them is central peak as seen is in elastic neutron scattering shown in this plot. All three curves are taken below TC. This is the lower temperature. You have spin wave emission absorption. Then as you heat it up, the spin wave peaks get softened a little bit, but you also have a central component developing already below TC, suggesting some unusual short wavelength spin dynamics. There is also a pseudo gap and electronic density of states near and below TC, which I'm going to mention later on. And as I said, the important thing is resistivity peak near the Curie transition. Okay. Now, among the basic physical ingredients here are the localized spins of manganese ions made out of T2G electrons with magneto spin state halves and conduction electrons from EG states of the manganese deep band, which hop between these. There is a strong ferromagnetic Kunz-Rolle exchange between those, which gives rise to double exchange ferromagnetism. I have no time to explain what it is, but probably it's familiar. There is a consensus that double exchange is the origin of ferromagnetism in the manganates, and that double exchange provides the linkage between transport and magnetic properties. However, the double exchange picture apparently does not adequately describe neither the generic physics of the manganites nor the magnitude of magnetic resistance. And the question is, what are other ingredients that need to be added to double exchange? When people think about the origins of the resistivity peak, there are two ways to think about it. One is so-called phase separation scenario, whereby you have below TC ions of paramagnetic insulator developing within ferromagnetic metallic matrix, and at some point your metallic state loses connectivity and you go through the resistivity maximum and TC at the same time, ending up in a paramagnetic insulator. The other view of things is the so-called two-fluid picture, whereby below TC you have itinerant electrons coexisting with localized carriers, and as you rise temperature, electrons go from itinerant Fermi to localized states, which would be the origin of TC. It appears to me that this picture is more generic. but I just mentioned both of them for the purpose of video. Okay, so we want to think what is needed to construct the generic model of similar compounds, what are the important common features. And we have to start with strongly correlated behavior seen there. Here you see the depletion of the density of states which develops in the metallic phase below Gc as seen by STM, and you also see it on Arcus. You also see the decrease in the effective carrier number. In optics, these are all clearly strongly correlated features consistent with the large expected Hubbard repulsion, which is the largest energy scale in the problem. There is also experimental evidence pointing at the presence of spin minority carriers there. It comes from point contact Andreev scattering. You can define the quantity Pn, which is the ratio here. You see density of states for two spin components are weighted with corresponding Fermi velocities. And if you calculate P0 without any Fermi velocity, you are fairly far from complete spin polarization, it's 78%. If you weigh with Fermi velocity squared, which is what enters the transport, you are nearly completely spin polarized, so people suggest calling it transport half metal as opposed to simple half metal. You still have spin minority states in the Fermi surface, although they don't contribute much to the transport. Now this is an agreement also with spin structure manipulation, which invariably show this is in a spin minority band. You typically have a flat band in spin minority channel close to the Fermi level. Let us think what should be the relevant orbitals of the manganese ions. This is the T-shell of manganese ion, split by crystal field in 22J and the J, and further split by Young Taylor. And the two components are shifted by Kunz-Rüth relative to each other. However, since all of these are d orbitals, Kunz-Rüth should be about the same for EJ and T2J states. That means that in the spin minority channel, T2G also must be coming below EG, and if you have only a few spin minority electrons present, those have to be T2G electrons. So basically you have a broad EG band and a narrow T2G band. Now, there is an additional piece of experimental evidence coming from doping lanthanum manganese oxide with tetravalent cerium ions. This compound has 1.3 electrons per unit cell. It's also ferromagnetic and shows CMR. However, the magnitude of resistivity is two orders of magnitude higher, and B, tunneling clearly shows that current is carried by spin minority electrons, which means that 0.3 extra electrons per formula unit went into spin minority T2G states consistent with what I was saying earlier. Now, based on these ideas, I introduced the following simplified model, which has itinerant carriers, localized states, hybridization between them. Everyone repels everyone else by Hubbard. You have super exchange, and you have a strong Kunz-Rüth coupling. S is the in addition to the two electrons, is the large spin on every side. So basically, I took the D shell of manganese ion, I lumped these two guys together into side spin S, and treat only one T2G band explicitly and only one EG band explicitly. Now, then I construct 1 over S expansion for the total spin on side T, and go to a new quantization, spin quantization action axis for the fermions. There is some transformation which you can find in my paper. And at this point, I can take the limiting case sending this down. Oops, too far. And sending this up, So I'm left with one component of EG band and one component of T2G band in the opposite spin channels. Now let us look at the Hamiltonian, which is an expansion in powers of 1 over square root of S. You have now two kinds of spinless fermions, G and F, where G are broadband coming originally from EG, and F is a narrow band coming from T2G spin minority. And this main term is the Fallikoff-Kimball model. Next term is magnon-assisted hybridization. It is a magnon operator. It has to be magnon-assisted because if you want to hop from this state to this state, you need to take these guys out of alignment. And it also resides on large values of magnon momenta Q consistent with unusual shortwave spin dynamics which you want to get. And then next term is magnon dynamics from super exchange, double exchange band narrowing effects, and Zeeman shifts. Now for the beginning I did a simple mean field treatment in terms of this average values, notice the presence of diagonal average value, and these are qualitatively the results which are obtained from moderate U. This mean field, this particular mean field is not stable at large U. I have to do better. First you have hybridization between itinerant and localized band. You have a direct gap opening here, which is a new small energy scale, and the quasi-particle weight as you approach the gap decreases. So this is the Fermi level, and this is quasi-particle weight here at the Fermi level as a function of temperature. You see it's quite low and decreases with temperature. Also, because of the kinematics in this case, when you the two components of your electron bands, one is broad, the other is narrow, the Stoner continuum extends all the way down to zero temperature, zero energy and zero momentum, and because of that spin stiffness acquires imaginary partner, which is consistent with strong spin wave damping. I'm sorry, I should have said that this reduced quasi-particle weight is at least reminiscent of pseudo gap that I was mentioning before. So, of course, one needs to continue this by including, by doing more advanced mean field, and the first thing I'm going to do is including the effects of direct T2G hopping, which it seems to be a very important perturbation of this model. Now, there is a question how to experimentally verify the relevance of this thing. And it seems that what needs to be done, you have basically a finite temperature, fluctuating spin. What you need to do, you need to measure the length of those fluctuating spins. Because here, right, the total length depends on my relative population. When electrons go from EG to T2G, the length of the spin changes. The question is how to do that. It can be done, apparently, by muons, by NMR, correct me if I'm wrong, and by neutrons, by studying longitudinal spin dynamics. But in all cases, it's not a straightforward measurement, often involving additional modeling. So the ideal thing would be to measure the length of the fluctuating spin and to try to correlate it with the transport and electronic properties. So these are basically my conclusions, that there is a solid motivation to include spin minority T2G electrons in the generic model of the manganese. This is based on experimental data and band structure calculation. I showed you a maximally simplified model as I put basically get which belongs to the general family of two fluid descriptions of the manganese. Mean field analysis, however tentative, suggests that quasi-particle weight is strongly suppressed already at low T and decreases further with temperature, and you have unusual spin rate damping. I suppose that this direction merits further theoretical and experimental attention. These are my acknowledgments, both for knowledge and for money. Thank you.
So can I ask, quickly ask, so the Z, the reduction of the quasi particle wave, that's
yes.
due to the coupling to spin, to quantum fluctuation of the spin?
Now, that would happen always when you try to hybridize a localized and itinerant state. However, there the hybridization was magnon assisted. So you need also to populate the magnon states. That's why the effects are more pronounced with temperature.
Okay. So you, So, but occupying the magnon states means what in this case? Is it static or is it? Is
no, you heat it up. You create magnons. That's your job.
More questions, Daniel.
Yeah. Did you check actually the stability of your solution with respect to eventual phase separation? Because it's known that double exchanges are very often unstable to phase separation. And also Fallica-Kimball, if you take it as such, without long-range Coulomb forces, then very often this solution are unstable with respect to phase separation. Did you check your solution?
This is a correct question. And if I were to actually study competition of ferromagnetism here against super exchange, granting up super exchange, then I would have to check this definitely. However, super exchange doesn't change this picture qualitatively. So at least it's obvious that if J is equal to zero, then there is no reason. There's no term there that would be gaining from this separation.
I think maybe I remember that people also looked at Fallica-Kimball model and also claimed that it's also phase separation. That I don't remember exactly. That would change the use of myself, but Fallica-Kimball, there were such claims, but I think they don't know.
Yeah,
you
always have this argument that
the
long range Coulomb is right.
That's why I told you that I need only moderate Q values, because otherwise I would not get a solution for two partially Q values.
Some after state in the system and what is basically
oh, that's an excellent question. And I'm actually I gave a promise to one Arpus gentleman not to speak publicly about his data, but you in general, because Arpus should be able to see the orbital character of electrons in
life.
There is no clear data to this effect published so far. That's as much as I can tell.
You may publish soon.
But the ARPAS is, on the magnet, as far as I know, is always restricted to the two layer, the one equal to the one,
yes,
you show the double layer.
Yes, regarding ARPAS of the, in the magnet, there are believers and non-believers. That's also
this is a very subtle question where the doping is 0.3, you have one thing, and you look conservative, you have very small variation. But it's a very crowded area with people making a lot of claims, I would say, in Japan. That's what I know. No more questions? Still a question? Then thanks again.